My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are His, the valleys are His, the stars are His handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are His, the valleys are His, the stars are His handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do.
Well, great to have you back with us again for our family starter on this first Sunday in Advent, the last Sunday in November, and just 3 weeks to go till the end of term, and not very long after that until Christmas. I wonder how excited you are. Well, it's great to have you with us again, and we're going to start our time together now by praying. So if you want to, you can put your hands together. You don't have to, though. God listens to our prayers, however we do them. So let's pray the prayer coming up on the screen together. Dear God, because you are amazing, we want to know you better. Help us to learn and enjoy your most amazing story. Amen. Well, we're going to keep on learning that song we started last week with actions, learning about God's great big story, the best story in the world, how we're part of it, and how Christmas is part of it too. So let's get ready with our hands for the actions. I've got some pictures also coming in to help our story. So we're going to sing the first two verses and choruses of the song, and then Joe's going to tell you a little bit more about what we're doing. Great. Enjoy.
Creation, Adam and Eve and the fall, of Babel. God had a plan. He told Abraham and promised his family would be God's people in God's place under his rule. They will know his blessing, his blessing, his blessing. God's people in God's place under his rule, they will know his blessing, his blessing, his blessing. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, 12 sons, a nation of slaves in Egyptian hot sun. But God had a plan through Moses, his man. He rescued them so they could be God's people in God's place under his rule. They will know his blessing, his blessing, his blessing. God's people in God's place under his rule. They will know his blessing, his blessing.
Hello, family starter. I don't know about you, but I've started to notice things getting even more Christmassy. I noticed a Christmas tree in somebody's window with all the decorations on. We haven't got ours yet, but we have got some things down from the loft. We're starting to get ready. We've got this ready, for example, our Advent calendar. I wonder if you've got one of those. We've got all different sorts, actually, but this one, I think, has got some yummy things inside. But it's also helping us to remember the true story of Christmas. And the grown-ups might be looking at something like this. Lots of the grown-ups in our churches are looking at these. It's a little bit like an Advent calendar, but it's a book, and there's a little bit to read each of the days. So we're counting down to Christmas. But do you remember last week? We were thinking about how Christmas, we're not just counting down now. It's actually counting down all the way from the beginning of a great big story. And this is a really important part of the whole story. So, can you remember what we had in our song? We had God's people in God's place, under his rule, and they will know his blessing. So I've got some things to help us think about that. Here we go. We've got some people. Hold on a minute. They look like they need a bit of a place though, don't they? Let's get them a place. So So we've got God's people in God's place. Under his rule, and they will know his blessing. God's people, in God's place, under his rule, they will know his blessing. I wonder if you could make something like that this week. We'd love to see your pictures of them. You could use Play-Doh, you could colour a picture, you might have some figures a little bit like this. We're going to sing our song now to help us remember some more. Remember the actions? God's people, in God's place, under his rule, they will know his blessing. Hope you enjoy it.
Creation, Adam and Eve and the fall.
Well, let's pray as we finish. Father God, we want to be your people, your family. We want to be with you for now and forever. And we want to be living your good way. Help us, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, there's some colouring in for you to do now of our puzzle pieces. Hope you enjoy that. See you next week.
Well, good morning and welcome to our Advent Sunday worship this final Sunday in November. It's great to have you with us. My name is Tudor and I'm hoping I've been praying that in this time we'll be able to put aside the franticness of Black Friday shopping and of Christmas planning and instead would focus on the Lord who rules over all, the one who gives peace, perfect peace. We're going to begin our service today by reading some of Psalm 25. In fact, throughout the service, we're going to read the whole of Psalm 25, bit by bit along the way. The first bit will come up on the screen now. Please do join me as we read it together. In you, Lord my God, I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord, teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour, and my hope is in you all day long. So as we begin our service then, let's pray the words on the screen. Heavenly Father, our ever-present help in trouble, our fortress and our God, calm the anxious fears of all who turn to you. Give strength and healing to those who are sick, and courage and skill to those who care for them. Grant wisdom and clarity to those in authority, and humble us to call upon you, that we may be saved not only in this life, but also for that which is to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, we worship God because he is awesome. And our opening song proclaims this. Let's sing together then, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made. Let's sing.
Throughout trumpets shout our acclamation, and take me home, for joy shall fill my heart. When shall I bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art? Then sings thy soul, thy Saviour God to thee, how great thou art.
Well, Advent is here, the season of the church year when we anticipate the return of the Lord Jesus, the second coming that he promised. We're going to turn now to our Advent wreath here, 5 candles which we're going to light on each Sunday and then on Christmas Day during Advent. And as we light the first candle, we are reminded of God's promise of a saviour, God's promise of a saviour. Let me read to you from Jeremiah, chapter 33. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfil the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. God's promise of hope is for all people. And together we anticipate the day of his return. And we claim the righteousness that Jesus won for us when he died on the cross in our place. Let us pray. Holy God, you have promised to bring salvation and justice to your creation. As we wait for the return of our Saviour, may we live as those who have already been saved by your grace, and may we share that grace with others. Amen.
Well, one of the promises that was made about Jesus comes in our first Bible reading from Isaiah chapter 64, which Peter Ward will now read for us. Isaiah chapter 64.
Isaiah 64, verse 1. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you, as when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we didn't expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to help to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continued to sin against those ways, you were angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sins. Yet, Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. O look upon us, we pray, for we are all your people.
Thank you, Peter. As we approach our time of confession, we're going to continue reading through Psalm 25. The words will come on the screen now. Let's say them together. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. Let us then pray together our prayer of confession, coming on the screen now. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. We continue reading Psalm 25 now. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right, and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful toward those who keep the demands of his covenant. For the sake of your name, Lord, forgive my iniquity, though it is great. And through the death and resurrection of Jesus, for the honour of his name, God forgives all who put their faith in him now. So may the Lord, the God of love and power, forgive us and free us from our sin, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Well, at many times in our lives, and particularly through the current pandemic, we realise that there's so much that we don't know, so much we can't control. But as Christians, we can still be at peace because we know the one who is in control, the one who does know. So then let's encourage one another as we sing together When We Walk With the Lord.
Bye.
trust and obedience isn't just keeping out of trouble. It's not just being seen to be good. No, no, it's a mindset that realises that all we have is not our own. It's given to us in trust for the glorification of God, for his purposes. And that's why you'll find that greed is so rightly condemned in the Bible. And generosity is praised, because what we have is not our own. As an organisation, our churches depend on your partnership, giving your time, your talents, and your money. And you'll realise that with physical collections now not coming in and church events are unable to happen that raise funds, many of our income streams are not happening. But the need to share Jesus with everyone is still very much there. In fact, it's even clearer now than at other times. Our expenses remain too. So if you're not already giving electronically, may I ask you to do so? The links are in the description for this service and the weekly email we sent out, the ways that you can give electronically, whether a one-off or on a regular basis. Let's now affirm that faith which we share in God, whom we trust and obey, whose generosity is our joy and our hope. Let's affirm our faith together.
Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So let us express our faith as God's people together as we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen.
Well, before Dorothy Derrick leads our intercessions, we're going to pray together the new Diocesan God for All Vision Refresh Prayer. That's a mouthful, isn't it? The words will be coming up on the screen now. Let's pray together. Living Lord, as we offer to you our common life, refresh our vision, that we may know your will and seek to follow in all your ways. May we follow daily as your disciples, care deeply for one another in community, speak boldly your gospel words of love, and tread gently as faithful stewards of your goodness. We ask this in the power of your holy name, as creator, redeemer, and sustainer of our lives, today and forever. Amen. Well, Dorothy will now lead us in our intercessions.
Let us pray. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Enter into our darkness with your light. Come, fill our emptiness with your presence. Dispel the clouds and reveal your glory. Come, refresh, renew, restore us. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Come, Lord, be known in your church, for without you we have no message, we have no power. Come, fill us with your presence, that we may proclaim your peace. Lord, make us aware, alerted to your coming, that we may reveal your glory in the world. We pray for those who walk in darkness, that they may see your light. We remember those whose lives are clouded with troubles, and pray that they may behold your glory. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Come, Lord, and give peace to your world. Disperse the clouds of war and violence, of pandemic and disaster. Let your power and your glory be revealed to the nations. We pray for those who work in our hospitals, doctors, nurses, and healthcare assistants, for our ambulance drivers, as well as our police force and firefighters, for those who are seeking and discovering vaccines to preserve life. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Come, Lord, be known in our homes, that they may reflect your love. We look forward to the time when we may welcome other people in. Meantime, may we be sensitive to the needs of others. Come into our workplaces, come into our churches, and we pray for them to be open to all who would come to pray. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Come, Lord, to all who are finding it difficult to cope at this time, to all who are housebound, to all who are lonely, we ask that you would surround them with your love. We pray for all who are sick, at home, in hospital, or in care. We pray for all who care for them, that they may have strength and patience. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Come, Lord, giver of life eternal, that we pray for those who have died, those known to each of us, and those known to God alone. In a few moments of quiet, we remember by name those known to us. We pray that they may rejoice in your closer presence for all eternity. Come, Lord, come down, come in, come among us. Amen.
Thank you, Dorothy. Please do, if you'd like to add the names of people you know who are in need of prayer, who you value all of us praying for, into the comment section in our Facebook page. But right now, we join with Christians across Cumbria as we say the Diocesan coronavirus prayer. Loving God, as your Son healed the sick and brought good news to the needy, be with us this day. Loving Jesus, as you taught us to do unto others as you would have them do to you, be with all in the caring professions this day. Loving Spirit, your gift is healing. Bring your healing fire to our homes, our hospitals, and our country. But most of all, be with us this day. Amen. Well, we're going to continue now with Sue Ward.
In the past, at our United Benefice services on Fifth Sunday, we used to offer the opportunity for anyone who wished to receive prayer for healing for themselves or for someone they loved. As COVID has rearranged our lives, we can no longer do this at a live service, and we don't yet know how long it will be before we can. But Jesus is not limited by this. He's here with us now. Jesus, the light of the world, represented by this candle. So I invite you, anybody who would like this ministry, to come now before the Lord and hear him speaking into their hearts words of healing and love. Lord Jesus, we ask you to meet each one who is turning to you at their deepest place of need, and to bring them your healing and wholeness, your shalom peace. Now, amen.
Our next song calls us to both acknowledge the presence of God, but also to delight in him. Let's sing together then, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
Still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Bow down before him now in reverence and fear. In him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Be still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned. How awesome is the sight! Our radiant King of light. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. Be still, for the power of the Lord is moving in this place. He comes to cleanse and heal, to minister his grace. No work too hard for him. In faith receive from him. Be still, for the power of the Lord is moving in this place.
Well, God is with us. So how should we respond? Let's read a bit more of Psalm 25 together, words coming up on the screen. Who then are those who fear the Lord? He will instruct them in the ways they should choose. They will spend their days in prosperity, and their descendants will inherit the land. The Lord confides in those who fear him. He makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever on the Lord, for only he will release my feet from the snare. So then let's fix our eyes on God. Let's listen to his instruction for us now, as Jesus teaches his disciples how to live between his first coming and his second advent. Let's listen as Claire Notman reads to us from Mark chapter 13 before Vera preaches.
Mark chapters 13 verses 24 to 37. But in those days following that distress, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. But about that day or hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Be alert. You do not know when that time will come. It is like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with their assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight, or when the cock crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone. Watch.
Our loving Father, as we come now to your word, speak through my words to inspire and encourage us, so that all may come to love you more dearly and follow you more nearly day by day. In the late 70s, there was a TV series created by Roald Dahl. It was called Tales of the Unexpected. The programme was only about half an hour long, and the tales were described as of the unexpected, because there was always a twist in the story that no one expected, no matter how hard you try to second guess it. We're all now very familiar with these things. Is this our own tale of the unexpected? Who, less than 12 months ago, could have predicted our current state of affairs? If someone had stood up in Schlupp Square in Carlisle at this time of year last year and said, at this time next year, we'll be in the midst of a pandemic we'll be having to face, singing happy birthday twice whilst washing our hands, wearing masks, using hand sanitizer, socially distancing, keeping 2 metres apart, quite understandably, we'd have thought they were quite mad. Even as I speak today, we're not 100% sure of how things are going to develop or if things will improve so that we can get back to normality. As we live our everyday lives and go about our business, we never know when things will change. This year, only with hindsight, we know they have. These changes create disruption in our ordered lives, create difficulties which we never had to overcome before. Otherwise, we may have been better prepared. Contemporary society wants to be in charge, wants to know what's going to happen next, when we will emerge from this pandemic, and even try to predict when the pandemic will be beaten into retreat. We'll see this morning how all this links in with our gospel reading. To put the passage into context, this episode takes place after Jesus prophesied the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem by telling the disciples when they are actually looking from the Mount of Olives across to the magnificent temple that not one stone of it will remain. Probably in disbelief, the disciples push him then to tell them when this will happen, but they also want to know what the signs will be that will signal that this is about to happen. He answers both questions by warning against deceivers and false prophets and false signs, and warns that they are merely the beginning of things to come. Things will get much worse before they get better, the like of which has never been witnessed before. So in this passage, Jesus begins by saying, "But in those days, following that distress," and quotes from Isaiah 13, verse 10, "The sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken." These graphic images illustrate doomsday language in the extreme, a picture of absolute devastation. Many view these words as being fulfilled figuratively in Isaiah's time, perhaps this cosmic darkness as a symbol of God's judgment in the form of the coming captivity of the Jews in Babylon. Whilst others see this as a literal darkness that will be fulfilled in the future, namely at the second coming of Jesus. In heaven and on earth, the cosmos will be rocked and shaken as God, in the person of the Son, prepares to come in judgment. George Beasley Murray, a 20th century evangelical Christian, suggests that this does not describe a dissolution of the cosmos, but it's a picture of it in terror and confusion before the overwhelming might of the Lord when he steps forth into the world to act in judgment and salvation. Far from us being in control, Jesus will then be in complete control. When Jesus returns, he'll send his angels to collect the elect, who are those who have faithfully responded to the gospel and who will be collected from wherever they reside for protection and reward. In verse 28, Jesus uses a parable to explain to the disciples that just as the fig tree bursts into life and summer is imminent, so it will be with the second coming. Once the signs described in verses 24 to 26 appear, the Son of Man will be seen in the clouds, coming in great power and glory. But by then, sadly, for many, it will be too late to accept him as Lord and Saviour. There has been much debate about this generation in verse 30 and what its precise meaning is. Several theories have been espoused. It's often understood to mean that all things prophesied in this chapter would take place while the men of Christ's day were still living. But it cannot mean that, because many of the events, especially those in verses 24 to 27, simply had not taken place. This generation may mean this race, or this Jewish race. The testimony of history is that this generation has not passed away. The Jewish nation as a whole has survived, but it is scattered around the globe. Or it may just mean the generation who will be alive at the end times will see that these things when they come to pass. History will come to an end. This present heaven and earth will give way to a new heaven and a new earth. But God's words will never pass away. Nothing is so true, stable, permanent and abiding as the word of our Lord. Here is a firm foundation on which we can stand forever. The prophet Isaiah was inspired to write, "The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God remains forever." So why is Jesus so vague about the timing? He doesn't want his followers to be continually trying to work out when he will return. If we were meant to know, he would have been more precise, but rather Jesus wants his disciples, including us, to be ready for anything at any time. I'm sure all of us have heard it said that the world will come to end on this day or that day, but the appointed dates come and go without anything happening. These predictions are false because there's no way anyone can predict the precise time of Jesus' return. Furthermore, we shouldn't be wasting time in trying to calculate when it will happen, because that will take us away from the real work of the church, which is that of mission and spreading the gospel for the glory of God. Scholars and scientists have recently been using modelling and algorithms to try and predict how the pandemic will behave. But no such algorithm is useful in predicting Jesus' return. In verses 32 to 37, Jesus explains that he's God our Father who knows the precise timing of when the last day will be. Not even the angels in heaven or Jesus himself knows. As part of the Godhead, why does Jesus not know? As he is speaking in this passage, Jesus is on earth in human form, so cannot use his divine powers for his own purposes. Rather, he submits to God the Father, who has already determined when the end will come, and he alone has that knowledge. We may not know when Jesus will return to consummate his kingdom, but as Christians we are certain he is coming, and we are told what we should be doing. Be alert. Watch. He may come today, tomorrow, or the next day. Are we ready? Uncertainty is one of the most difficult things to live with. We've all had experience of it at one time or another. COVID has turned all our lives upside down. We are uncertain about how the new normal will look. Whilst we wait for Jesus to return, we can react in one of three ways. First, it doesn't matter when he comes. If we don't believe that Jesus will return to judge the world, why should we worry about it? If it's God's desire that everyone will be saved, and by his grace he is waiting for that to happen, however, God won't wait indefinitely. If we choose to ignore Jesus and his saving message, then he will ignore us when the appointed hour he comes in judgment and we are found wanting. We can't be like an ostrich and bury our heads in the sand, hoping it will all go away. It won't. Even now there are people who dispute the severity of the pandemic, but the evidence is indisputable. We've seen much airtime spent on the development and discovery of a vaccine for COVID. It's certainly good news, but it's not the best news. Jesus is. So we must be prepared to give account of our actions, or lack of them, at any time. Secondly, we can try and work out when Jesus will return. We've already said that Jesus doesn't want us to waste time trying to second guess when he will come. Only God the Father knows. End of story. Remember tales of the unexpected? The third thing, we're told to watch out. Jesus tells us not once, but repeatedly, to watch. What if he returns and we're not prepared? What if we say we'll start to serve him tomorrow? Even in our earthly experience, we know tomorrow sometimes never comes. We prepare for and anticipate weddings, social events, and make sure we're ready when the time comes. The only difference is that we know when these events are going to take place. So as we draw to a close, why don't we all make sure that we're ready for Jesus? The key word of the chapter, right from the beginning in verse 5, was the command, watch. Now at the end it is repeated once more, but this time it's no longer addressed only to the four disciples, but to everyone. In this way, Jesus shows his concern not only for the disciples, but for the whole community and his followers for whom he was about to die. And his message is watch. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that all people throughout the world will be ready when your Son returns. We pray that your Holy Spirit will assist us in preparing and anticipating for that time, by preparing our hearts and minds, not tomorrow, not next week, but today. Amen.
Oh, thank you, Vera, for guiding us through that tricky passage. Of those three responses, it's quite easy, isn't it, to do that first one, of basically living as if Jesus wasn't coming back. I think it doesn't matter. But Jesus says it does. I doubt most of us are tempted to work out when it'll happen, but maybe you know some people who are. But let's try and aim for that third response, of living, watching out for him, living in the light of his return now, in confidence and in hope. Well, let me read from the end of Psalm 25 and the words coming on the screen, and we'll read that together now. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. Relieve the troubles of my heart and free me from my anguish. Look on my affliction and my distress and take away all my sins. See how numerous are my enemies and how fiercely they hate me. Guard my life and rescue me. Do not let me be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness protect me, because my hope, Lord, is in you. Deliver Israel, O God, from all their troubles. Well, there's David. He was in trouble. But he said, we can look to God with confidence and hope, and so can we today. We've got a message of hope, a message of confidence. And isn't it great that we can share that particularly well at Christmas time? So let's be praying for our neighbours and friends, and let's be inviting them to both our online carol services, details in the parish magazine and in the email for this. And the notices, but also now we know we can have physical services, even though we're tier two. There are some physical services at Christmas. Please do be supporting those in your prayers and your presence if you feel able, and inviting others too. Coming up this week, we have our Eat, Pray, Love, our Wednesday evening discussion group following Sunday's sermon. A great chance to catch up and pray together as well. We also have a particular prayer time, Thursdays at 1 o'clock. Which we do both on Zoom, but also just in your own homes if you're unable to join us on Zoom. And again, it would be great if you can join us for our Zoom coffee now, our discussion and chat and catch up. If you want to drop me an email at vicartudor@gmail.com or phone me on 01228 576 324, and I'll tell you how you can phone in if you can't use the Zoom app. be great if you can share that time of fellowship and encouragement with us. Right now, though, let's close together in prayer with the words on the screen. Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, feeding us with your word, and encouraging us in our meeting together. Take us and use us to love and serve you and all people. Amen. Well, may the blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. In that confidence, then, let's look forward to the return of Jesus as we sing, Lo, he comes on clouds descending, where the clouds, of course, show him, Jesus, being having the power of God, the presence of God. That's what the significance of the clouds are. Let's sing, Lo, he comes with clouds descending.
Once more to see it all.
peaceful in gentleness through the violence of these days. Give freely, show tenderness in all your ways. Through darkness, in troubled times, let holiness be your aim. Seek wisdom, let faithfulness burn like a flame. God speed you, God lead you, and keep you wrapped around His heart. May you be known by love. Be righteous, speak truthfully in a world of greed and lies. Show kindness, see everyone through heaven's eyes. God hold you, enfold you, and keep you wrapped around His heart. May you be known by love. May you be known by love.